The dean wanted to apologize. She is actually at a conference somewhere in Tampa, and so she asked me to introduce the speakers tonight. But I will follow her traditional routine, which is to also announce a series of other events that will follow this lecture, so that you get the information and that you follow up and try to attend. The first thing that is important is that following this lecture today, there will be, as you can see in preparation in the gallery over there on February 1st, which I believe is Monday, there will be the opening and a lecture about that exhibition, which puts into contrast Shanghai and Miami Beach. With a series of photographs that come out of a book that was published a couple of years ago. Following up in the week after, there will be the opening of an exhibition, as well as a conference on the restoration of the tower in Pisa, Italy. That's in association with the School of Engineering. Then later on, mid-month, on the 17th, I'll have the honor to present a new book that was published by Routledge in England with a colleague of mine from the University of Houston, which is called Modern Architecture in the Mediterranean. We will present it here and then in other venues in the city. The day after, that will be it will be Alan Schulman at Books and Books presenting his major work on post-war Miami, Miami Modern Metropolis. Later on, March 3rd, we'll have Edith Kedan, who's a faculty member at FIU, who will be also talking about her research, and which is on contemporary architecture. And we welcome an exchange between the two schools, because I think Catherine is lecturing there, and we're going to try to do that more often. There will be then other presentations, other books coming out, particularly I'm sorry, I should have turned this thing off. by Carrie Penabab and Catherine Lynn on Marion Manley, the first woman architect, registered architect in Florida, coming out from Georgia University Press, and so on and so on. So there's really a lot of events in terms of other names. We will have also some important people that still have to be confirmed. For example, Adrian Goese from the firm West 8 in Rotterdam, who is working on a project in Miami Beach in front of the Frank Gehry building, which is to open soon, as you probably know. So coming to today, Terry Riley and John Keenan are our visiting critique for the year, for the semester, which means that they have an upper level design studio. I will introduce them now. John joined us from New York City. And Terry from Miami. I will start with John because we know you less. John Keenan, the firm is Keenan Terry Riley. John Keenan received his Master's of Architecture degree from Columbia University, went on to work in the New York office of Skidmore, Owings & Merrill before founding Keenan Riley, K/R, in 1984, has taught, lectured, and exhibited his work at numerous institutions, including Harvard Graduate School of Design, Rhode Island School of Design, Parsons School of Design, Syracuse University, and many others. He has been the recipient of Graham Foundation grants and has twice been a finalist for the prestigious international award Andrea Palladio for architecture. K/R was also selected to exhibit his work as part of the Emerging Voices program at the Architecture League in New York. In addition, John co-curated the 1998 exhibition Tony Smith's Architect, Painter, and Sculptor at the New York Museum of Art. They're working together now on various projects in New York, Long Island, Miami, and Spain. Terry Riley, that you probably know better because Terry just completed his term as director of the Miami Art Museum. And thanks to his effort and his work, we will have soon, hopefully, the groundbreaking of the new Miami Art Museum, Barrett Soc-Pomeron, in the Bicentennial Park. So that's, but before that, the first time we actually met was, and I don't exactly remember whether it was the fall of 2001 or the spring of 2002, the students organized a conference on the post 9/11 events, and that you came actually And I think that was the first time that we received you at the school, and a very interesting event. Terry has studied at the University of Notre Dame and then Columbia University, worked for various architects in the United States and Europe before founding with John Keenan Reilly in 1984. He's an author, contributor to various journal publications, lectures frequently, has taught at Harvard School of Design and other schools of architecture, has served on very important juries and prizes, such as the competition for the Reina Sofía National Museum in Madrid, the memorial for the 9/11 Memorial of the Pentagon in DC, and the Museum of Latin American Art in Buenos Aires. More importantly, perhaps from cultural, for the relationship of architecture and culture, he was from 1991 to 2005 the chief curator of the Department of Architecture and Design at the Museum of Modern Art in New York City, and then, as I mentioned, director of the Miami Art Museum. At the Museum of Modern Art, he produced and curated a significant amount of exhibition, and I will only mention the important one, the double project on Mies in Berlin, accompanying Mies in the States, Mies in America. That was a great capital event for MoMA in recent years, and also a recent exhibition on modern architecture in Spain. As Terry stepped down from the museum, they have opened opened the firm. The firm now has two offices, if I understood, and he has kindly agreed to be our first visiting critic of the year. So please welcome John and Terry Reilly.
Thanks very much. The introduction, I think, reminds me that John and I have actually been quite lucky in our practice, continue to be quite lucky, in the sense that when we graduated from graduate school, this notion that an architect could be someone who designs buildings, of course, but also someone who undertakes research, teaches, writes, curates, all this seemed to sort of flow out of the same kind of education that we got, and I think it's been a very, and continues to be, I feel, a great way to work, as an architect in the fullest sense, and approaching architecture from many different angles. I'm going to use a book we published last year as a kind of armature for the lecture, and I'd have to say John did the most work on the book. You would think a book was a relatively easy thing to do now that so many million have been printed, but I think architects like design problems, and once the more you learn about book publishing, the more fascinated you become by all the little details and things to talk about. It took like a year to do the book or something like that. But the title is Projects, Writings, and Buildings, and the title's meant to embrace theoretical work, work that isn't really visual but is written, as well as building and all the issues that actually building something take into place. We had to talk about every single aspect. I brought the copy of the book to show you how big it is. How big it is was a very big discussion. We started doing this when Rem Koolhaas unleashed the big book craze, and we decided we weren't going to do a big book since everybody else was. But we talked a lot about books, and we wanted it to be like a handbook. We wanted it to be like something like a guide, like a book somebody would carry with them. So we decided it would not be a coffee table book, and made various other decisions which ensured that it would be commercially a total failure, starting with publishing on the cover an image by Tim Davis. And I don't know if any of you know Tim Davis's photography, but he's a very well-regarded fine arts photographer. He photographed one of our projects. We just let him in the front door and let him do whatever he wanted to do, to avoid the kind of typical architectural photographs. But of course, those are the kind of photographs that do wind up on those covers of books. The challenge, though, of doing a book is actually quite interesting, because I think books are fairly architectural in their DNA. Linguistically, it's kind of interesting when you have a, when you typeset the book, that block of type is referred to as a column of type. In traditional books, the first letter is a capital letter and was often made larger and decorated. So you had the capital, and it's the same root word as the capital of a column, and that's where it would be. In Spanish, the frontispiece is called a portada, a portal. And so there's actually a kind of, often in Spanish books, the portada is portrayed as a page with architectural elements, etc. So we very much enjoyed thinking about the book as kind of piece of architecture, all of its different pieces. This is the end papers, which I don't think really have much function anymore. And so somehow this design is about some mix between function and pure decoration. And also some attempt to capture the fact that an office is more than just what it produces, but it's also a kind of life of its own. And then some just random images. John, I don't even remember what this was. Something in Queens?
It's a K artist, a graffiti artist in New York who happens to share a name.
Ah, okay. Do we get permission to do that? Okay. So the intention was not to like do the book necessarily chronologically or thematically, but to sort of present the what we'd been doing in full. It does start with one of our first projects, though. This is this was a wonderful project. It's in New Jersey. The bottom portion of the structure is actually what's left of an 18th century flax mill in New Jersey. Right behind the photographer, there's actually a stream that used to be the mill stream. And we rebuilt those walls, inserted this platform above it that also had this screened-in porch, and expanded it, as you can see, to the left of the slide, with a small kitchenette. It was really, you know, in terms of a type, it's a small structure on a bigger estate, specifically for playing billiards in downstairs, and then the platform above for outdoor dining. So it's what they would have called a casino in a more traditional architectural language. And it was certainly a moment for us to indulge in the sort of architectonic culture that we had been raised in at Columbia, you know, under the influence of Ken Frampton. But this whole ability to deal with this kind of masonry, steel, wood, et cetera, was truly a great project without too much of a demand in the program. Another interesting typology, and I think one of the first things that you begin to see is in this approach to architecture that we've taken, again, a very non-commercial approach, in every other aspect of contemporary life, you see lawyers who are no longer lawyers. They're either divorce lawyers or they're real estate lawyers or whatever. What they try to do is do what they do over and over and over again, and contemporary culture rewards this kind of specialization. It's also not as interesting, though, and I think John and I have continuously been drawn towards the new, something that hasn't been done before, rather than developing that sort of specialty that is rewarded, you know, economically in modern times. This is a boathouse and a footbridge. It's on the East River in New York City. It was never built, unfortunately, but it was a wonderful little project. Up in the top of this image, you see this asphalt plant. Those of you that know New York City, there's a former asphalt plant in a kind of paraboloid shape near the East River, and that was the location of this boathouse. Again, a kind of architectonic expression, a very fancy shed. And then another building type, not so typical. This is an aviary that we built in the Dominican Republic. If you look at the black and white slide in the middle, the geometry of These supports came from the realization that the steel members were about the size of the palm trees, and of course the palm trees all came at, you know, various skewed angles, so the idea was to make it as unobtrusive as possible. With the enclosure for the birds. The idea was that if there was a hurricane, the mesh would blow away and the birds would fly away and not be harmed, rather than trying to make it a rigid cage that held them in. In fact, there was a hurricane, the birds all flew away and the building was torn down. So it doesn't exist anymore. Part of Keenan Riley's life has also been urban projects, whereas, you know, architecture schools then and now, you know, obviously focus a lot on buildings, on freestanding buildings. The intensity of working in New York also guides architects towards interiors in a way that I think doesn't happen quite so intensively elsewhere. And I think in this project, this is foundation offices on the Upper East Side. That kind of intensity of architectonic expression that you saw in the initial projects is something that often becomes part of the language of the interior as well. Perhaps, again, to use the same word, in a more intense way than it might elsewhere. I mean, in New York, interiors really become a kind of architecture of a different scale. The opportunities for freestanding buildings in New York City are actually few, but in this case, this was a small addition in Long Island City, designed for Edwina Van Gaal, is that correct? The landscape designer. And then another urban environment, Miami Beach. This being a totally interior job that was actually also meant to be rather inexpensive and to be a kind of antidote to the kind of office landscape that we were seeing arising everywhere. So these are like almost a kit of parts. Sheets of frosted plexiglass, ribs made out of keyed boards, et cetera, et cetera. And it became a whole environment, like I said, as a kind of antidote to the landscape that was more typical of the moment. And certainly part of the working in and around New York is being involved in not only remaking the smallest scale, but trying to rethink the largest scale. This was a proposal for 42nd Street. This was done at a time where the whole West Side was still virtually the Wild West, shall we say. It's hard to imagine that in so few years since we were thinking about this edge of Manhattan, Frank Gehry has built buildings there, the whole Chelsea north-south corridor from the convention center to downtown has actually been completely kind of transformed. Back in Miami, Tuttle Street in the Design District, a building, this was a commercial building, actually conceived as a kind of drive-by building, even though this is a walking part of Miami Beach, or Miami, and conceived as a sort of, there was a Muybridge image there, each of the storefronts having its own view box, if you will, to people driving by. The work that we have done outside of cities has tended to be, not surprisingly, single-family houses. This is a house in New Jersey, a house that we have felt was very closely tied in with certain notions about the landscape, might even say romantic ideas of the landscape that urban dwellers have. It was built, I suppose, maybe it's a very urban gesture that an urbanite wants to establish a courtyard or a more kind of civilized outdoor place. But that is what was at the center of the home. And you can see it splits between two forms, the garage, the house, and the extension to the north, or I'm sorry, that's to the east. This is a theme that actually comes back in some of the other houses we've done. And I can show you one later that is just now finishing. This is a project we did very early on. This is more, shall we say, exurban, on an island in Maine called North Haven. And it was essentially a one volume space. And it was built on an island that was famous for its granite quarries, so that the podium, if you will, that the building sits on was a projected as a granite base. And then it was also an island that had a lot of shipbuilding, recreational, you know, sailing boats, fishing boats. So they had a kind of terrific wood crafting heritage. So the combination of this kind of socle or podium of granite and then this kind of lightweight wood structure, the underside of which would resemble a boat, became the device to kind of route this to its site. Exhibition design, this is something that it actually predated my going to MoMA, and to tell you the truth, it again I think grew out of an architectural education that I think was very challenging at Columbia at the time. It was very broad based, and quite frankly, the first exhibition I did was in at Columbia, and it was on an architect called Paul Nelson, who lived and worked in France. And somebody asked, I remember when I did the exhibition at that time, that they said, oh, do you want to be a curator? And I, actually that was Philip Johnson, but my response was, yeah, I was sort of surprised by the question. And I said, no, not really. I had never thought of doing things like exhibitions to be a whole separate career from being an architect. I think John and I, throughout our career, have seen and thought of teaching, writing, curating exhibition designs as something that kind of grew quite naturally out of an architectural education. The other thing that I think does come from an architectural education is the architectural sense of history. I don't believe you can actually be an architect without being at least what you would call a self-taught historian. History is part and parcel of how architects learn how to be architects. And I know that when I was in the museum world, which I was for quite some time, a lot of people would always say, is your background, are you a historian? And I said, after a while, my response was always the same, only to the extent that all architects are historians and think are able to organize their thoughts historically in terms of precedent and even as they develop new ideas. So John also has this gene. This is a design by John for the, the centenary exhibition of Steuben Glass. And then a number of images on the left. That was an exhibition I did called The Unprivate House. A multimedia table, again, sort of extension of various other ways of thinking. Light construction on the upper right, show done by John at MoMA on the architect and sculptor and painter Tony Smith, and a few other images. John, this was mainly John. I was not involved in these projects. You never know where your career is going to take you. John had an opportunity to design two airplanes, the first of which was a Gulfstream, and it's a kind of fantastic interior that you think of as traveling 600 miles an hour or whatever at 20,000 feet. But in almost all other respects, the same sort of tectonic and material qualities as a lot of the other projects. And then Boeing had a limited competition where they invited a number of architects. Boeing kind of woke up after Gulfstream had sold about $10 billion worth of private planes and decided that they were going to try to get some of that market. And they actually held this competition to turn 737s into private jets. An early project we did at school in the Bronx. I think the most important reason for putting this here in this was to underscore the importance of architects doing competitions and staying open to those sorts of activities, even as it becomes more and more complicated to do them. I think that actually the economy is changing in such a way that it makes it more interesting for architects to spend more time doing this than maybe they did in recent years. Two other projects, again in Florida, one in Palm Island in Miami Beach. This was a project, one of the great things as you continue to evolve in terms of your design is meeting wonderful people to work with. This was a project that we did with Edwina Van Gaal, the landscape designer that John had done that little office for in Queens. But as you get deeper and deeper into the profession and you come to understand more and more how other professionals can kind of enrich your work, I think you really come to fully understand architecture as a collaborative effort that is just enriched every time you can kind of lay in another layer of another professional's work. Somebody in my studio this semester said, "Do you mind if we work as a team? I'd like to work with one other person as a team." And I said, "You're going to spend the rest of your life working as a team. I think it's terrific that you want to do that, you know, at this point." Another aviary we were designed for in Mexico. Again, it's a kind of fantastic program. It's really a huge volume of space, big enough to allow birds to act and do what they want to do with very little else in terms of the program. A project for the design district. This is very close to, what's it called, John? The space that some University of Miami architects, it's a street that connects 40th and 39th, Palm Court. And this is the street straight ahead is the extension of that urban intervention. This is, and it shows the way that a career kind of unfolds. John had taken this interest in the work of Tony Smith, and Tony Smith was more or less a sort of self-taught architect who became a self-taught painter, who became a self-taught sculptor of great renown. His earliest career, though, was as I said, a self-taught architect. He became very enamored of Frank Lloyd Wright. Later, learning from other sources, and he did this wonderful house in Guilford, Connecticut. And the only preservation project that Keene Riley has ever been involved with is actually this house, and it's a house that Tony Smith did. John, what year was the house built? 52. And this is a diagram from the Tony Smith archives that shows the kind of complex geometries that he was projecting on this site, which was a kind of hilltop overlooking the Long Island Sound. And as you can see, it is a wonderful piece of architecture with an amazing number of influences from different sources. There's this kind of Le Corbusian volume up on Pilotes, but if you look closely, they're not Pilotes, they're these big tree trunks. And picking up different references in terms of other modern architects and the other aspects of the house. And then this was some offices in Miami Beach, which was Tim Davis did the photo essay on the sort of totally anti-architectural photographs. And then the split house, which again, I think maybe this is an urban dweller's fear of suburban living, where the house is continuously split to create a space in between, or maybe it's the fear of undefined exterior space. And this house is finished, John, or two volumes: one, the smaller volume, a garage, artist studio, and other spaces, and then the main house on the left, all of which is sort of anchored by a stair. Then another kind of interesting extension of one professional activity to the next. While doing the Mies, one of the exhibitions I did at MoMA was called Mies in Berlin, and it was a very in-depth look at Mies van der Rohe's work in Berlin before he emigrated to the U.S. In the 30s. And I became quite interested in the so-called courthouses, which were these, at the end of the research, what it became evident was that the courthouse, the so-called Miesian courthouse, was virtually, well, Mies used it as a teaching tool. He never actually designed, and you probably know this as well as anyone, never actually designed any of them for clients except for one. There was one great exception. But it was mainly a teaching tool that he used with his students. And all of those amazing drawings at the Museum of Modern Art are actually all totally theoretical projects. He liked to continuously sketch them, etc. But it was really, a project that was meant for teaching. A lot of Miesian architects, Philip Johnson, the gentleman in Houston named Todd, so on and so forth, went on to actually build courthouses. But interestingly enough, Mies never did himself. So I actually became interested in building a house in Florida, and John Bennett and I, with KR, designed this house and actually built two of them. The idea that Mies had about these courthouses was, in my opinion, that they were not, as Philip Johnson built his, a luxury product, a luxury house. They were meant to be smaller houses that would be built, side by side to maximize the number of houses per acre. And they were to be built in these little colonies at great efficiencies of scale. Mies starts teaching and presenting this type of projects to his students in the early 30s, and it's after he's taken over the Bauhaus after the relatively short stint by Hans Meyer. Hans Meyer was very progressive socially and politically. A lot of people thought that Mies was inappropriate for the Bauhaus, that he was too conservative, that he was too indebted to his wealthy clients, et cetera, et cetera. And it's my belief, after studying all these documents, that Mies imagined the courthouse as his response to his critics, that he wasn't interested in social housing. Mies did have a problem with social housing in terms of minimal sized apartment flats. He didn't think that was an appropriate way for people to live. And so these minimal houses that he imagined did have what he considered to be the kind of importance for elements for living. They had air, they had sun, they had identity, they had their own door. And it's during this period that he develops these houses. Now, the ones that we built are a little bit of a reference to Philip Johnson's townhouse. Well, in the lower right-hand corner here, you see the two houses. Two houses were built. We wanted to build two instead of one to emphasize that they were meant as a, thank you, they were meant as a colony of houses, not as a single one-off house. And what they consist of is each one has a garden in the front, a living space, a covered terrace, a lap pool with a bridge, two bedrooms, and then the back garden. So they're rather small. They're 3,200 square feet within the walls, each unit. But of that 3,200 square feet, only 1,600 is air conditioned. So it's a rather small, modest house. Has a lot of, as Mies envisioned, it has a lot of things that a larger house, bourgeois, if you will, house, a middle-class house would have: privacy, light, air, etc. But it's built in a very condensed fashion. So every room looks out either into a garden or into the courtyard. And we also picked up on a Miesian theme. Mies had in the courthouse projects, he never actually attempted anything like this in a real project. He imagined that art and architecture could be fused together, and he imagined this by having walls as murals, that one would begin to think of the architecture and the art as being one. So we actually also projected the house to have a certain number of murals. In the end, we also added, there's also artwork in the house at this point. But in the beginning, the notion was that all the art would be integrated with the architecture. In today's world, that also meant digitally. So in the instance of this exterior wall, that became a wall that was used for digital art in terms of projections, etc. Anyway, it's a wonderful house. It wouldn't really work anywhere else. It had to be built in Florida or a climate like this. And for all this talk of it being a Miesian house, Cynthia Davis, who was Cynthia Davidson, who is the author, is the editor of Log and worked on all the Any projects with Peter Eisenman, who's her husband. When she came to see it, she said she didn't really get Mies at all. She said it looked very Neutra, it looked very West Coast, looked very David Hockney with a swimming pool and all that. And I realized, materials do mean something, and they have different associations, and that imagery of the white walls and the pools and all of that certainly were suggestive. Otherwise, certainly a team effort. The end papers, and back to the end of the back of the book. So thanks very much. Enjoyed being here. Looking forward to working with you all this semester.